Rogue fluffs. One of these days, I'll cut my hair. But I need to get barbering tools first. Hello, Alex. Stay hydrated. Of course, you can't let it get corked. That is Friday night, the perfect night for a good glass of wine and a story, maybe a little bit of charcuterie. I just finished eating a large late supper salad. I had a fairly late lunch and then I was out cycling around, so... All right. Well, it's 8:32, so why don't we recap? In our last session, let's see, Judson Parker, who was going to put up... Judson Parker? I think so. Yes, Judson Parker was going to rent the fence space, all of his fence space, along the Newbridge Road to medical advertisement companies, which would have been rather an eyesore. So, as it happened, he was caught in his own cleft stick and was overheard by Anne by accident, making a rather nasty political deal with someone. He was caught selling his vote. And decided suddenly to be virtuous and not to rent his fence, conditionally upon Anne not telling anyone. Anne was not going to tell anyone anyways, but Judson Parker is the kind of person who wouldn't have believed that because he measured her by his own stick. And then Anne started her summer vacation and is now preparing for the visit of the illustrious Mrs. Charlotte Morgan, and has just struck a deal with Davy to be very, very good, and in return, she'll row Davy and Dora down to the bottom of the pond for a picnic. So, let us take up the thread of our narrative. Chapter 17, a chapter of accidents. Anne woke three times in the night and made pilgrimages to her window to make sure that Uncle Abe's prediction was not coming true. Finally, the morning dawned pearly and lustrous, in a sky full of silver sheen and radiance, and the wonderful day had arrived. Diana appeared soon after breakfast, with a basket of flowers over one arm and her muslin dress over the other, for it would not do to don it until all the dinner preparations were completed. Meanwhile, she wore her afternoon pink print and a lawn apron, fearfully and wonderfully ruffled and frilled, and very neat and pretty and rosy she was. "You look simply sweet," said Anne admiringly. Diana sighed. "But I've had to let out every one of my dresses again. I weigh 4 pounds more than I did in July. Anne, where will this end? Mrs. Morgan's heroines are all tall and slender. Well, let's forget our troubles and think of our mercies, said Anne gaily. Mrs. Allen says that whenever we think of anything that is a trial to us, we should also think of something nice that we can set over against it. If you are slightly too plump, you've got the dearest dimples, and if I have a freckled nose, the shape of it is all right. Do you think the lemon juice did any good?
Yes, I think it did, said Diana critically.
And much elated, Anne led the way to the garden, which was full of airy shadows and wavering golden lights. We'll decorate the parlor first. We have plenty of time, for Priscilla said they'd be here about 12 or half past at the latest, so we'll have dinner at 1. There may have been two happier and more excited girls somewhere in Canada or the United States at that moment, but I doubt it. Every snip of the scissors, as Rose and Peony and Bluebell fell, seemed to chirp,
Mrs. Morgan is coming today.
Anne wondered how Mr. Harrison could go on placidly mowing hay in the field across the lane, just as if nothing were going to happen. The parlor at Green Gables was a rather severe and gloomy apartment, with rigid horsehair furniture, stiff lace curtains, and white antimacassars that were always laid at a perfectly correct angle, except at such times as they clung to unfortunate people's buttons. Even Anne had never been able to infuse much grace into it, for Marilla would not permit any alterations. But it is wonderful what flowers can accomplish if you give them a fair chance. When Anne and Diana finished with the room, you would not have recognized it. A great blue bowl full of snowbells. I think that's a misprint. Snowbells overflowed on the polished table. The shining black mantelpiece was heaped with roses and ferns. Every shelf of the whatnot held a sheaf of bluebells. The dark corners on either side of the grate were lighted up with jars full of glowing crimson peonies, and the grate itself was aflame with yellow poppies. All this splendor and color, mingled with the sunshine falling through the honeysuckle vines at the windows, in a leafy riot of dancing shadows over walls and floor, made of the usually dismal little room the veritable bower of Anne's imagination, and even extorted a tribute of admiration from Marilla, who came in to criticize and remained to praise.
Now we must set the table, said Anne, in the tone of a priestess about to perform some sacred rite in honor of a divinity. We'll have a big vase full of wild roses in the center, and one single rose in front of everybody's plate, and a special bouquet of rosebuds only by Mrs. Morgan's, an allusion to the rosebud garden, you know.
The table was set in the sitting room, with Marilla's finest linen and the best china, glass, and silver. You may be perfectly certain that every article placed on it was polished or scoured to the highest possible perfection of gloss and glitter. Then the girls tripped out to the kitchen, which was filled with appetizing odors emanating from the oven, where the chickens were already sizzling splendidly. Anne prepared the potatoes, and Diana got the peas and beans ready. Then, while Diana shut herself into the pantry to compound the lettuce salad, Anne, whose cheeks were already beginning to glow crimson, as much with excitement as from the heat of the fire, prepared the bread sauce for the chickens, minced her onions for the soup, and finally whipped the cream for her lemon pies. And what about Davy all this time? Was he redeeming his promise to be good? He was indeed. To be sure, he insisted on remaining in the kitchen, for his curiosity wanted to see all that went on. But as he sat quietly in a corner, busily engaged in untying the knots in the piece of herring net he had brought home from his last trip to the shore, nobody objected to this. At 11:30, the lettuce salad was made, the golden circles of the pies were heaped with whipped cream, and everything was sizzling and bubbling that ought to sizzle and bubble.
"We'd better go and dress now," said Anne, "for they may be here by 12. We must have dinner at sharp 1, for the soup must be served as soon as it's done."
Serious indeed were the toilet rites presently performed in the east gable. Anne peered anxiously at her nose and rejoiced to see that its freckles were not at all prominent, thanks either to the lemon juice or to the unusual flush on her cheeks. When they were ready, they looked quite as sweet and trim and girlish as ever did any of Mrs. Morgan's heroines.
"I do hope I'll be able to say something once in a while and not sit like a mute," said Diana anxiously. "All Miss Morgan's heroines converse so beautifully, but I'm afraid I'll be tongue-tied and stupid. And I'll be sure to say, I seen. I haven't often said it since Miss Stacy taught here, but in moments of excitement it's sure to pop out. And if I were to say I seen before Mrs. Morgan, I'd die of mortification, and it would be almost as bad to have nothing to say. I'm nervous about a good many things, said Anne, but I don't think that there is much fear that I won't be able to talk. And to do her justice, there wasn't. Anne shrouded her muslin glories in a big apron and went down to concoct her soup.
Oh, pardon me. Salad apparently makes me yawn.
Marilla had dressed herself and the twins and looked more excited than she had ever been known to look before. At 12:30, the Allens and Miss Stacy came. Everything was going well, but Anne was beginning to feel nervous. It was surely time for Priscilla and Mrs. Morgan to arrive. She made frequent trips to the gate and looked anxiously down the lane as ever her namesake in the Bluebeard story peered from the tower casement.
"Suppose they don't come at all," she said piteously. "Don't suppose it. It would be too mean," said Diana,
who, however, was beginning to have uncomfortable misgivings on the subject.
"Anne," said Marilla, coming out from the parlor, "Miss Stacy wants to see Miss Barry's willowware platter."
Anne hastened to the sitting-room closet to get the platter. She had, in accordance with her promise to Mrs. Lynde, written to Miss Barry of Charlton, asking for the loan of it. Miss Barry was an old friend of Anne's, and she promptly sent the platter out, with a letter exhorting Anne to be very careful of it, for she had paid $20 for it. The platter had served its purpose at the Aid Bazaar, and had then been returned to the Green Gables closet, for Anne would trust nobody but herself to take it back to town. She carried the platter carefully to the front door, where her guests were enjoying the cool breeze that blew up from the brook. It was examined and admired, and then, just as Anne had taken it back into her own hands, a terrific crash and clatter sounded from the kitchen pantry. Marilla, Diana, and Anne fled out, the latter pausing only long enough to set the precious platter hastily down on the second step of the stairs. When they reached the pantry, a truly harrowing spectacle met their eyes. A guilty-looking small boy scrambling down from the table, with his clean print blouse liberally plastered with yellow filling, and on the table the shattered remnants of what had been two brave, becreamed lemon pies. Davy had finished ravelling out his herring net and had wound the twine into a ball. Then he had gone into the pantry to put it up on the shelf above the table, where he already kept a score or so of similar balls, which, so far as could be discovered, served no useful purpose save to yield the joy of possession. Davy had to climb onto the table and reach over to the shelf at a dangerous angle, something he had been forbidden by Marilla to do, as he had come to grief once before in the experiment. The result in this instance was disastrous. Davy slipped and came sprawling squarely down on the lemon pies. His clean blouse was ruined for that time, and the pies for all time. It is, however, an ill wind that blows nobody good, and the pig was eventually the gainer by Davy's mischance.
"Davy Keith," said Marilla, shaking him by the shoulder, "didn't I forbid you to climb up on that table again? Didn't I?"
"I forgot," whimpered Davy. "You've told me not to do such an awful lot of things that I can't remember them all."
"Well, you march upstairs and stay there till after dinner. Perhaps you'll get them sorted out in your memory by that time. No, Anne, never you mind interceding for him. I'm not punishing him because he spoiled your pies. That was an accident. I'm punishing him for his disobedience. Go, Davy, I say."
"Ain't I to have any dinner?"
wailed Davy. "You can come down after dinner is over and have yours in the kitchen."
"Oh, all right," said Davy, somewhat comforted. "I know Anne'll save some nice bones for me, won't you, Anne? 'Cause, you know, I didn't mean to fall on the pies. Say, Anne, since they are spoiled, can't I take some of the pieces upstairs with me?"
"No, no lemon pie for you, Master Davy," said Marilla, pushing him toward the hall.
"What shall we do for dessert?" asked Anne, looking regretfully at the wreck and ruin.
"Get out a crock of strawberry preserves," said Marilla consolingly. "There's plenty of whipped cream left in the bowl for it."
1 o'clock came, but no Priscilla or Mrs. Morgan. Anne was in an agony. Everything was done to a turn, and the soup was just what soup should be, but couldn't be depended on to remain so for any length of time.
"I don't believe they're coming after all," said Marilla crossly.
Anne and Diana sought comfort in each other's eyes. At 1:30, Marilla again emerged from the parlor.
"Girls, we must have dinner. Everybody is hungry, and it's no use waiting any longer. Priscilla and Mrs. Morgan are not coming, that's plain, and nothing is being improved by waiting."
Anne and Diana set about lifting the dinner, with all the zest gone out of the performance.
I don't believe I'll be able to eat a mouthful, said Diana dolefully.
Nor I, but I hope everything will be nice for Mrs. Stacy's and Mr. and Mrs. Allen's sake, said Anne listlessly.
When Anne dished the peas, she tasted them, and a very peculiar expression crossed her face.
Anne, did you put sugar in these peas?
Yes, said Anne, mashing the potatoes with the air of one expected to do her duty. I put a spoonful of sugar in. We always do. Don't you like it?
But I put a spoonful in, too, when I set them on the stove, said Diana.
Anne dropped her masher and tasted the peas also. Then she made a grimace.
How awful! I never dreamed you had put sugar in, because I knew your mother never does. I happened to think of it for a wonder. I'm always forgetting it, so I popped a spoonful in.
It's a case of too many cooks, I guess, said Marilla,
who had listened to this dialogue with a rather guilty expression.
I didn't think you'd remember about the sugar, Anne, for I'm perfectly certain you never did before, so I put in a spoonful.
The guests in the parlor heard peal after peal of laughter from the kitchen, but they never knew what the fun was about. There were no green peas on the dinner table that day, however.
Well,
said Anne, sobering down again with a sigh of recollection,
we have the salad anyhow, and I don't think anything has happened to the beans. Let's carry the things in and get it over.
It cannot be said that dinner was a notable success socially. The Allens and Miss Stacy exerted themselves to save the situation, and Marilla's customary placidity was not noticeably ruffled. But Anne and Diana, between their disappointment and the reaction from their excitement of the forenoon, could neither talk nor eat. Anne tried heroically to bear her part in the conversation for the sake of her guests, but all the sparkle had been quenched in her for the time being, and in spite of her love for the Allens and Miss Stacy, she couldn't help thinking how nice it would be when everybody had gone home, and she could bury her weariness and disappointment in the pillows of the East Gable. There is an old proverb that really seems at times to be inspired. It never rains, but it pours. The measure of that day's tribulations was not yet full. Just as Mr. Allen had finished returning thanks, there arose a strange, ominous sound on the stairs, as of some hard, heavy object bouncing from step to step, finishing up with a grand smash at the bottom. Everybody ran out into the hall. Anne gave a big shriek of dismay. At the bottom of the stairs lay a big pink conch shell amid the fragments of what had been Miss Berry's platter, and at the top of the stairs knelt the terrified Davy, gazing down with wide-open eyes at the havoc.
"Davy," said Marilla ominously, "did you throw that conch down on purpose?"
"No, I never did," whimpered Davy. "I was just kneeling here quiet as quiet to watch you folks through the banisters, and my foot struck that old thing and pushed it off, and I'm awful hungry, and I do wish you'd lick a fellow and have done with, instead of always sending him upstairs to miss all the fun."
"Don't blame Davy," said Anne, gathering up the fragments with trembling fingers. "It was my fault. I set that platter there and forgot all about it. I'm properly punished for my carelessness. But, oh, what will Miss Berry say?"
"Well, you know she only bought it, so it isn't the same as if it was an heirloom," said Diana,
trying to console. The guests went away soon after that, feeling that it was the most tactful thing to do, and Anne and Diana washed the dishes, talking less than they had ever been known to do before. Then Diana went home with a headache, and Anne went with another to the East Gable, where she stayed until Marilla came home from the post office at sunset with a letter from Priscilla written the day before. Mrs. Morgan had sprained her ankle so severely that she could not leave her room.
"And, oh, Anne, dear," wrote Priscilla, "I'm so sorry, but I'm afraid we won't get up to Green Gables at all now, for by the time Auntie's ankle is well, she'll have to go back to Toronto. She has to be there by a certain date."
"Well," sighed Anne, laying the letter down on the red sandstone step of the back porch, where she was sitting while the twilight rained down out of a dappled sky,
"I always thought it was too good to be true that Mrs. Morgan should really come. But there, that speech sounds as pessimistic as Miss Eliza Andrews, and I'm ashamed of making it. After all, it was not too good to be true. Things just as good and far better are coming true for me all the time. And I suppose the events of today have a funny side, too. Perhaps when Diana and I are old and grey, we shall be able to laugh over them. But I feel that I can't expect to do it before then, for it has been truly a bitter disappointment. You'll probably have a good many more and worse disappointments than that before you get through life, said Marilla, who honestly thought she was making a comforting speech. It seems to me, Anne, that you are never going to outgrow your fashion of setting your heart so on things, and then crashing down into despair because you don't get them. I know I'm too much inclined that way, agreed Anne ruefully. When I think something nice is going to happen, I seem to fly right up on the wings of anticipation, and then the first thing I realize, I drop down to earth with a thud. But really, Marilla, the flying part is glorious as long as it lasts. It's like soaring through a sunset. I think it almost pays for the thud.
Well, maybe it does, admitted Marilla. I'd rather walk calmly along and do without both flying and thud. But everybody has her own way of living. I used to think there was only one right way, but since I've had you and the twins to bring up, I don't feel so sure of it. What are you going to do about Miss Barry's platter?
Pay her back the $20 she paid for it, I suppose. I'm so thankful it wasn't a cherished heirloom, because then no money could replace it.
Maybe you could find one like it somewhere and buy it for her.
I'm afraid not. Platters as old as that are very scarce. Mrs. Lynde couldn't find one anywhere for the supper. I only wish I could, for of course Miss Barry would just as soon have one platter as another, if both were equally old and genuine. Marilla, look at that big star over Mr. Harrison's maple grove, with all that holy hush of silvery sky about it. It gives me a feeling that's like a prayer. After all, when one can see stars and skies like that, little disappointments and accidents can't matter so much, can they?
Where's Davy? Said Marilla, with an indifferent glance at the star.
In bed. I promised to take him and Dora to the shore for a picnic tomorrow. Of course, the original agreement was that he must be good. But he tried to be good, and I hadn't the heart to disappoint him.
You'll drown yourself or the twins rowing about the pond in that flat, grumbled Marilla. I've lived here for 60 years, and I've never been on the pond yet.
Well, it's never too late to mend, said Anne roguishly. Suppose you come with us tomorrow. We'll shut Green Gables up and spend the whole day at the shore, daffing the world aside.
No, thank you, said Marilla with indignant emphasis. I'd be a nice sight, wouldn't I, rowing down the pond in a flat? I think I hear Rachel pronouncing on it. There's Mr. Harrison driving away somewhere. Do you suppose there's any truth in the gossip that Mr. Harrison is going to see Isabella Andrews?
No, I'm sure there isn't. He just called there one evening on business with Mr. Harmon Andrews, and Mrs. Lynde saw him and said she knew he was courting because he had a white collar on. I don't believe Mr. Harrison will ever marry. He seems to have a prejudice against marriage.
Well, you never can tell about those old bachelors. And if he had a white collar on, I'd agree with Rachel that it looks suspicious, for I'm sure he never was seen with one before.
I think he only put it on because he wanted to conclude a business deal with Harmon Andrews, said Anne. I've heard him say that's the only time a man needs to be particular about his appearance, because if he looks prosperous, the party of the second part won't be so likely to try to cheat him. I really feel sorry for Mr. Harrison. I don't believe he feels satisfied with his life. It must be very lonely to have no one to care about except a parrot, don't you think? But I notice Mr. Harrison doesn't like to be pitied. Nobody does, I imagine.
There's Gilbert coming up the lane, said Marilla. If he wants you to go for a row on the pond, mind you put on your coat and rubbers. There's a heavy dew tonight.
Well, what a chapter of accidents indeed.
Chapter 18, An Adventure on the Tory Road.
Anne, said Davy, sitting up in bed and propping his chin on his hands, Anne, where is sleep? People go to sleep every night, and of course I know it's the place where I do the things I dream, but I want to know where it is, and how I get there and back without knowing anything about it, and in my nightie, too. Where is it?
Anne was kneeling at the west gable window, watching the sunset sky that was like a great flower with petals of crocus and a heart of fiery yellow. She turned her head at Davy's question and answered dreamily, Over the mountains of the moon, down in the valley of the shadow. Paul Irving would have known the meaning of this, or made a meaning out of it himself, if he didn't. But practical Davy, who, as Anne often despairingly remarked, hadn't a particle of imagination, was only puzzled and disgusted.
Anne, I believe you're just talking nonsense.
Of course I was, dear boy.
Don't you know that it is only very foolish folk who talk sense all the time?
Well, I think you might give a sensible answer when I ask a sensible question, said Davy in an injured tone.
Oh, you are too little to understand, said Anne, but she felt rather ashamed of saying it, for had she not, in keen remembrance of many similar snubs administered in her own early years, solemnly vowed that she would never tell any child it was too little to understand? Yet here she was doing it. So wide sometimes is the gulf between theory and practice.
Well, I'm doing my best to grow, said Davy, but it's a thing you can't hurry much. If Marilla wasn't so stingy with her jam, I believe I'd grow a lot faster.
Marilla is not stingy, Davy, said Anne severely. It's very ungrateful of you to say such a thing.
There's another word that means the same thing and sounds a lot better, but I just don't remember it, said Davy, frowning intently. I heard Marilla say she was it herself the other day.
If you mean economical, it is a very different thing from being stingy. It's an excellent trait in a person if she's economical. If Marilla had been stingy, she wouldn't have taken you and Dora when your mother died. Would you have liked to live with Mrs. Wiggins?
You just bet I wouldn't. Davy was emphatic on that point. Nor I don't want to go to Uncle Richard, neither. I'd far rather live here, even if Marilla is that long-tailed word when it comes to jam, because you're here, Anne. Say, Anne, won't you tell me a story before I go to sleep? I don't want a fairy story. They're all right for girls, I suppose, but I want something exciting, lots of killing and shooting in it, and a house on fire, and interesting things like that.
Fortunately for Anne, Marilla called out at this moment from her room.
Anne, Diana's signaling at a great rate. You'd better see what it is she wants.
Anne ran to the east gable and saw flashes of light coming through the twilight from Diana's window in groups of five, which meant, according to their old childish code, come over at once, for I have something important to reveal. Anne threw her white shawl over her head and hastened through the haunted wood and across Mr. Bell's pasture corner to Orchard Slope.
I've good news for you, Anne, said Diana. Mother and I have just got home from Carmody, and I saw Mary Sentner from Spencervale in Mr. Blair's store. She says the old cock girls on the Tory Road have a willowware platter, and she thinks it's exactly like the one we had at the supper. She says they'll likely sell it, for Martha Copp has never been known to keep anything she could sell, but if they won't, there's a platter at Wesley Keeson's at Spencervale, and she knows they'd sell it, but she isn't sure it's just the same kind as Aunt Josephine's.
I'll go right over to Spencervale after it tomorrow, said Anne resolutely, and you must come with me. It will be such a weight off my mind, for I have to go to town day after tomorrow, and how can I face your Aunt Josephine without a willowware platter? It would be even worse than the time I had to confess about jumping on the spare room bed.
Both girls laughed at the old memory, concerning which, if any of my readers are ignorant and curious, I must refer them to Anne's earlier history. The next afternoon, the girls fared forth on their platter-hunting expedition. It was 10 miles to Spencervale, and the day was not especially pleasant for travelling. It was very warm and windless, and the dust on the road was such as might have been expected after 6 weeks of dry weather.
"Oh, I do wish it would rain soon," sighed Anne. "Everything is so parched up. The poor fields just seem pitiful to me, and the trees seem to be stretching out their hands pleading for rain. As for my garden, it hurts me every time I go into it. I suppose I shouldn't complain about a garden when the farmer's crops are suffering so. Mr. Harrison says his pastures are so scorched up that his poor cows can hardly get a bite to eat, and he feels guilty of cruelty to animals every time he meets their eyes."
After a wearisome drive, the girls reached Spencervale and turned down the Tory Road, a green, solitary highway where the strips of grass between the wheel tracks bore evidence to lack of travel. Along most of its extent, it was lined with thick-set young spruces crowding down to the roadway, with here and there a break where the back field of a Spencervale farm came out to the fence, or an expanse of stumps was aflame with fireweed or goldenrod.
"Why is it called the Tory Road?" asked Anne.
"Mr. Allen says it is on the principle of calling a place a grove because there are no trees in it," said Diana, "for nobody lives along the road except the Copp girls and old Martin Bovier at the further end, who is a Liberal. The Tory government ran the road through when they were in power, just to show they were doing something."
Diana's father was a Liberal, for which reason she and Anne never discussed politics. Green Gables folks had always been conservatives. Finally, the girls came to the old Copp homestead, a place of such exceedingly external neatness that even Green Gables would have suffered by contrast. The house was a very old-fashioned one, situated on a slope, which fact had necessitated the building of a stone basement under one end. The house and outbuildings were all whitewashed to a condition of blinding perfection, and not a weed was visible in the prim kitchen garden surrounded by its white paling. "The shades are down," said Diana ruefully. "I believe that nobody is home." This proved to be the case. The girls looked at each other in perplexity. "I don't know what to do," said Anne. "If I were sure the platter was the right kind, I would not mind waiting until they came home. But if it isn't, it may be too late to go to Wesley Keeson's afterwards." Diana looked at a certain little square window over the basement. "That is the pantry window, I feel sure," she said, "because this house is just like Uncle Charles at Newbridge, and that is their pantry window. The shade isn't down, so if we climbed up on the roof of that little house, we could look into the pantry and might be able to see the platter. Do you think it would be any harm?" "No, I don't think so," decided Anne, after due reflection, "since our motive is not idle curiosity." The most disimportant point of ethics being settled, Anne prepared to mount the aforesaid little house, a construction of lathes with a peaked roof, which had in past time served as a habitation for ducks. The Copp girls had given up keeping ducks, because they were such untidy birds, and the house had not been in use for some years, save as an abode of correction for setting hens. What a turn of phrase. An abode of correction for setting hens. Although scrupulously whitewashed, it had become somewhat shaky, and Anne felt rather dubious as she scrambled up from the vantage point of a keg placed on a box. "I'm afraid it won't bear my weight," she said as she gingerly stepped on the roof.
"Lean on the windowsill,"
advised Diana, and Anne accordingly leaned. Much to her delight, she saw as she peered through the pane a willow-ware platter, exactly such as he was in quest of, on the shelf in front of the window. So much she saw before the catastrophe came. In her joy, Anne forgot the precarious nature of her footing, incautiously ceased to lean on the windowsill, gave an impulsive little hop of pleasure, and the next moment she had crashed through the roof up to her armpits, and there she hung, quite unable to extricate herself. Diana dashed into the duck house, and seizing her unfortunate friend by the waist, tried to draw her down. "Ow! Don't!" shrieked poor Anne. "There are some long splinters sticking into me. See if you can put something under my feet. Then perhaps I can draw myself up." Diana hastily dragged the previously mentioned keg, and Anne found that it was just sufficiently high to furnish a resting place for her feet, but she could not release herself.
"Could I pull you out if I crawled up?" suggested Diana.
Anne shook her head hopelessly.
"No, the splinters hurt too badly. If you can find an axe, you might chop me out, though. Oh, dear, I do really begin to believe that I was born under an ill-omened star."
Diana searched faithfully, but no axe was to be found.
"I'll have to go for help," she said, returning to the prisoner. "No, indeed you won't," said Anne vehemently. "If you do, the story of this will get out everywhere, and I shall be ashamed to show my face. No, we must just wait until the Copp girls come home and bind them to secrecy. They'll know where the axe is, and get me out. I'm not uncomfortable as long as I keep perfectly still. Not uncomfortable in body, I mean. I wonder what the Copp girls value this house at. I shall have to pay for the damage I've done, but I wouldn't mind that if I were only sure they would understand my motive in peeping in at their pantry window. My sole comfort is that the platter is just the kind I want, and if Miss Copp will only sell it to me, I shall be resigned to what has happened."
"What if the Copp girls don't come back until after night, or till tomorrow?" suggested Diana.
"If they're not back by sunset, you'll have to go for other assistance, I suppose," said Anne reluctantly. "But you mustn't go until you really have to. Oh, dear, this is a dreadful predicament. I wouldn't mind my misfortune so much if they were romantic, as Mrs. Morgan's heroines always are. But they're always just simply ridiculous. Fancy what the Copp girls will think when they drive into their yard and see a girl's head and shoulders sticking out of the roof of one of their outhouses. Listen, is that a wagon?"
"No,
Diana, I believe it is thunder.
Thunder it was, undoubtedly. And Diana, having made a hasty pilgrimage around the house, returned to announce that a very black cloud was rising rapidly in the northwest.
I believe we are going to have a heavy thunderstorm, she exclaimed in dismay. Oh, Anne, what will we do?
We must prepare for it, said Anne tranquilly. A thunderstorm seemed a trifle in comparison with what had already happened.
You'd better drive the horse and buggy into that open shed. Fortunately, my parasol is in the buggy. Here, take my hat with you. Marilla told me I was a goose to put on my best hat to come to the Tory Road, and she was right, as she always is.
Diana untied the pony and drove into the shed, just as the first heavy drops of rain fell. Then she sat and watched the resulting downpour, which was so thick and heavy that she could hardly see Anne through it, holding the parasol bravely over her bare head. There was not a great deal of thunder, but for the best part of an hour the rain came merrily down. Occasionally Anne slanted back her parasol and waved an encouraging hand to her friend, but conversation at that distance and under the circumstances was quite out of the question. Finally the rain ceased, the sun came out, and Diana ventured across the puddles of the yard.
"Did you get very wet?"
she asked anxiously.
"Oh, no," returned Anne cheerfully. "My head and shoulders are quite dry, and my skirt is only a little damp where the rain beat through the lathes. Don't pity me, Diana, for I haven't minded it at all. I kept thinking how much good the rain will do, and how glad my garden must be for it, and imagining what the flowers and buds would think when the drops began to fall. I imagined out a most interesting dialogue between the asters and the sweet peas and the wild canaries in the lilac bush, and the guardian spirit of the garden. When I go home, I mean to write it down. I wish I had a pencil and paper to do it now, because I dare say I'll forget the best parts before I reach home."
Diana the Faithful had a pencil and discovered a sheet of wrapping paper in the box of the buggy. Anne folded up her dripping parasol, put on her hat, spread the wrapping paper on a shingle Diana handed up, and wrote out her garden idyll under conditions that could hardly be considered as favorable to literature. Nevertheless, the result was quite pretty, and Diana was enraptured when Anne read it to her.
"Oh, Anne, it's sweet, just sweet. Do send it to the Canadian woman."
Anne shook her head.
"Oh, no, it wouldn't be suitable at all. There's no plot in it, you see. It's just a string of fancies. I like writing such things, but of course nothing of the sort would ever do for publication, for editors insist on plots, so Priscilla says. Oh, there's Miss Sarah Copp now. Please, Diana, do go and explain."
Miss Sarah Copp was a small person, garbed in shabby black, with a hat chosen less for vain adornment than for qualities that would wear well. She looked as amazed as might be expected on seeing the curious tableau in her yard. But when she heard Diana's explanation, she was all sympathy. She hurriedly unlocked the back door, produced the axe, and with a few skillful blows set Anne free. The latter, somewhat tired and stiff, ducked down into the interior of her prison, and thankfully emerged into liberty once more.
"Miss Copp," she said earnestly, "I assure you I looked into your pantry window only to discover if you had a willow-ware platter. I didn't see anything else. I didn't look for anything else."
"Bless you, that's all right," said Miss Sarah amiably. "You needn't worry. There's no harm done. Thank goodness we cops keep our pantries presentable at all times and don't care who sees into them. As for that old duck house, I'm glad it's smashed, for maybe now Martha will agree to have it taken down. She never would before, for fear it might come in handy sometime, and I've had to whitewash it every spring. But you might as well argue with a post as with Martha. She went to town today. I drove her to the station. And you want to buy my platter. Well, what would you give for it?"
$20, said Anne, who was never meant to match business wits with a cop, or she would not have offered her price at the start.
"Well, I'll see," said Miss Sarah cautiously. "That platter's mine, fortunately, or I'd never dare to sell it when Martha wasn't here. As it is, I dare say she'll raise a fuss. Martha's the boss of the establishment, I can tell you. I'm getting awful tired of living under another woman's thumb. But come in, come in. You must be real tired and hungry. I'll do the best I can for you in the way of tea, but I warn you not to expect anything but bread and butter and some cowcumbers. Martha locked up all the cake and cheese and preserves before she went. She always does, because she says I'm too extravagant with them if company comes."
The girls were hungry enough to do justice to any fare, and they enjoyed Miss Sarah's excellent bread and butter and cowcumbers thoroughly. When the meal was over, Miss Sarah said,
I don't know as I mind selling the platter, but it's worth $25. It's a very old platter.
Diana gave Anne's foot a gentle kick under the table, meaning, don't agree, she'll let it go for 20 if you hold out. But Anne was not minded to take any chances in regard to that precious platter. She promptly agreed to give 25, and Miss Sarah looked as if she felt sorry she hadn't asked for 30.
Well, I guess you may have it. I want all the money I can scare up just now. The fact is, Miss Sarah threw up her head importantly, with a proud flush on her thin cheeks, I'm going to be married to Luther Wallace. He wanted me 20 years ago. I liked him real well, but he was poor then, and Father packed him off. I suppose I shouldn't have let him go so meek, but I was timid and frightened of Father. Besides, I didn't know men were so scarce.
When the girls were safely away, Diana driving and Anne holding the coveted platter carefully on her lap, the green, rain-freshened solitudes of the Tory Road were enlivened by ripples of girlish laughter.
I'll amuse your Aunt Josephine with the strange, eventful history of this afternoon when I go to town tomorrow. We've had rather a trying time, but it's over now. I've got the platter, and that rain has laid the dust beautifully, so all's well that ends well.
We're not home yet, said Diana rather pessimistically,
and there's no telling what may happen before we are. You're such a girl to have adventures, Anne.
Having adventures comes natural to some people, said Anne serenely. You just have a gift for them, or you haven't.
Chapter 19, not 29. I'm delighted that it makes you see the scenes, Aunt Sherry.
I aspire to that, although I think a good deal of that is due to L.M. Montgomery's authorship. She describes things so very well.
Chapter 19, Just a Happy Day.
After all, Anne had said to Marilla once, I believe the nicest and sweetest days are not those on which anything very splendid or wonderful or exciting happens, but just those that bring simple little pleasures, following one another softly, like pearls slipping off a string.
Life at Green Gables was full of just such days, for Anne's adventures and misadventures, like those of other people, did not happen all at once, but were sprinkled over the year with long stretches of harmless, happy days between, filled with work and dreams and laughter and lessons. Such a day came in August. In the forenoon, Anne and Diana rode the delighted twins down the pond to the sandshore to pick sweet grass and paddle in the surf, over which the wind was harping an old lyric learned when the world was young. In the afternoon, Anne walked down to the old Irving place to see Paul. She found him stretched out on the grassy bank beside the thick fir grove that sheltered the house on the north, absorbed in a book of fairy tales. He sprang up radiantly at the sight of her.
"Oh, I'm so glad you've come, teacher," he said eagerly, "because Grandma's away. You'll stay and have tea with me, won't you? It's so lonesome to have tea all by oneself. You know, teacher. I've had serious thoughts of asking young Mary Jo to sit down and eat her tea with me, but I expect Grandma wouldn't approve. She says the French have to be kept in their place."
Oh, again. Something gets age. Bit of casual racism there.
"And anyhow, it's difficult to talk with young Mary Jo. She just laughs and says, 'Well, you do beat all the kids I ever know.' That isn't my idea of conversation."
"Of course I'll stay to tea," said Anne gaily. "I was dying to be asked. My mouth has been watering for some more of your grandma's delicious shortbread ever since I had tea here before." Paul looked very sober.
"If it depended on me, teacher," he said, standing before Anne with his hands in his pockets and his beautiful little face shadowed with sudden care, "you should have shortbread with a right good will, but it depends on Mary Jo. I heard Grandma tell her before she left that she wasn't to give me any shortcake because it was too rich for little boys' stomachs. But maybe Mary Jo will cut some for you if I promise I won't eat any. Let us hope for the best."
"Yes, let us," agreed Anne, whom this cheerful philosophy suited exactly.
"And if Mary Jo proves hard-hearted and won't give me any shortbread, it doesn't matter in the least, so you are not to worry over that."
"You're sure you won't mind if she doesn't?" said Paul anxiously.
"Perfectly sure, dear heart."
"Then I won't worry," said Paul with a long breath of relief, "especially as I really think Mary Jo will listen to reason. She's not a naturally unreasonable person, but she has learned by experience that it doesn't do to disobey Grandma's orders. Grandma is an excellent woman, but people must do as she tells them.
She was very much pleased with me this morning because I managed at last to eat all my plateful of porridge. It was a great effort, but I succeeded. Grandma says she thinks she'll make a man of me yet. But, teacher, I want to ask you a very important question. You will answer it truthfully, won't you?
I'll try, promised Anne.
Do you think I'm wrong in my upper story?
Asked Paul, as if his very existence depended on her reply.
Goodness no, Paul, exclaimed Anne in amazement. Certainly you're not. What put such an idea into your head? Mary Jo, but she didn't know I heard her. Mrs. Peter Sloan's hired girl, Veronica, came to see Mary Jo last evening, and I heard them talking in the kitchen as I was going through the hall. I heard Mary Jo say, "That Paul, he's the queerest little boy. He talks so queer. I think there's something wrong in his upper story." I couldn't sleep last night for ever so long thinking of it and wondering if Mary Jo was right. I couldn't bear to ask Grandma about it somehow, but I made up my mind I'd ask you. I'm so glad you think I'm all right in my upper story. Of course you are. Mary Jo is a silly, ignorant girl, and you are never to worry about anything she says, said Anne indignantly, secretly resolving to give Mrs. Irving a discreet hint as to the advisability of restraining Mary Jo's tongue.
Well, that's a weight off my mind, said Paul. I'm perfectly happy now, teacher, thanks to you. It wouldn't be nice to have something wrong in your upper story, would it, teacher? I suppose the reason Mary Jo imagines I have is because I tell her what I think about things sometimes.
It is a rather dangerous practice, admitted Anne, out of the depths of her own experience.
Well, by and by I'll tell you the thoughts I told Mary Jo, and you can see for yourself if there's anything queer in them, said Paul. But I'll wait till it begins to get dark. That is the time I ache to tell people things, and when nobody else is handy I just have to tell Mary Jo. But after this I won't, if it makes her imagine I'm wrong in my upper story. I'll just ache and bear it.
And if the ache gets too bad, you can come up to Green Gables and tell me your thoughts, suggested Anne, with all the gravity that endeared her to children, who so dearly loved to be taken seriously.
Yes, I will, but I hope Davy won't be there when I go, because he makes faces at me. I don't mind very much, because he's still such a little boy, and I'm quite a big one, but it still is not pleasant to have faces made at you, and Davy makes such terrible ones. Sometimes I'm frightened he'll never get his face straightened out again. He makes them at me in church when I ought to be thinking of sacred things. Dora likes me, though, and I like her, but not so well as I did before she told Minnie Mae Barry that she means to marry me when I grew up. I may marry somebody when I grow up, but I'm far too young to be thinking of it yet, don't you think, teacher?
Rather young, agreed teacher.
Speaking of marrying, reminds me of another thing that's been troubling me of late, continued Paul. Mrs. Lynde was down here one day last week having tea with Grandma, and Grandma made me show her my little mother's picture, the one Father sent me for my birthday present. I didn't exactly want to show it to Mrs. Lynde. Mrs. Lynde is a good, kind woman, but she isn't the sort of person you want to show your mother's picture to. You know, teacher. But, of course, I obeyed Grandma. Mrs. Lynde said she was very pretty, but kind of actressy looking, and must have been an awful lot younger than Father. Then she said, "Some of these days your pa will be marrying again, likely. How would you like to have a new ma, Master Paul?" Well, the idea almost took my breath away, teacher, but I wasn't going to let Mrs. Lynde see that. I just looked her straight in the face, like this, and I said, "Mrs. Lynde, Father made a pretty good job of picking out my first mother, and I could trust him to pick out one just as good the second time. And I can trust him, teacher, but still, I hope if he ever does give me a new mother, he'll ask my opinion about her before it's too late. There's Mary Jo coming to call us to tea. I'll go and consult with her about the shortbread."
As a result of the consultation, Mary Jo cut the shortbread and added a dish of preserves to the bill of fare. Anne poured the tea, and she and Paul had a very merry meal in the dim old sitting room, whose windows were open to the gulf breezes, and they talked so much nonsense that Mary Jo was quite scandalized, and told Veronica the next evening that the school miss was as queer as Paul. After tea, Paul took Anne up to his room to show her his mother's picture, which had been the mysterious birthday present kept by Mrs. Irving in the bookcase. Paul's little low-ceilinged room was a soft whirl of ruddy light from the sun that was setting over the sea, and swinging shadows from the fir trees that grew close to the square, deep-set window. From out this soft glow and glamour shone a sweet, girlish face,
with tender mother eyes that was hanging on the wall at the foot of the bed. "That's my little mother," said Paul with loving pride. "I got Grandma to hang it there where I'd see it as soon as I opened my eyes in the morning. I never mind not having the light when I go to bed now, because it just seems as if my little mother was right here with me. Father knew just what I would like for a birthday present, although he never asked me. Isn't it wonderful how much fathers do know? Your mother was very lovely, Paul, and you look a little like her, but her eyes and hair are darker than yours." "My eyes are the same color as Father's," said Paul, flying about the room to heap all available cushions on the window seat. "But Father's hair is gray. He has lots of it, but it's gray. You see, Father is nearly 50. That's ripe old age, isn't it? But it's only outside he's old. Inside he's just as young as anybody. Now, teacher, please sit here, and I'll sit at your feet. May I lay my head against your knee? That's the way my little mother and I used to sit. Oh, this is real splendid, I think. Now, I want to hear those thoughts which Mary Jo pronounces so queer," said Anne, patting the mop of curls at her side. Paul never needed any coaxing to tell his thoughts, at least to congenial souls. "I thought them out in the fir grove one night," he said dreamily. "Of course, I didn't believe them, but I thought them. You know, teacher. And then I wanted to tell them to somebody, and there was nobody but Mary Jo. Mary Jo was in the pantry sitting bread, and I sat down on the bench beside her, and I said, 'Mary Jo, do you know what I think? I think the evening star is a lighthouse on the land where the fairies dwell.' And Mary Jo said, 'Well, you are the queer one. There ain't no such thing as fairies.' I was very much provoked. Of course, I knew there are no fairies, but that needn't prevent my thinking there is. You know, teacher. But I tried again quite patiently. I said, 'Well then, Mary Jo, do you know what I think? I think an angel walks over the world after the sun sets, a great tall white angel with silvery folded wings, and sings the flowers and birds to sleep. Children can hear him if they know how to listen.' Then Mary Jo held up her hands all over flower and said, 'Well, you are the queerest little boy. You make me feel scared.' And she really did look scared. I went out then and whispered the rest of my thoughts to the garden. There was a little birch tree in the garden and it died. Grandma says the salt spray killed it, but I think the dryad belonging to it was a foolish dryad who wandered away to see the world and got lost, and the little tree was so lonely it died of a broken heart. And when the poor foolish dryad gets tired of the world and comes back to her tree, her heart will break," said Anne. "Yes, but if dryads are foolish, they must take the consequences, just as if they were real people," said Paul gravely. "Do you know what I think about the new moon, teacher? I think it is a little golden boat full of dreams. And when it tips on a cloud, some of them spill out and fall into your sleep." "Exactly, teacher. Oh, you do know. And I think all the violets are little snips of the sky that fell down when the angels cut out holes for the stars to shine through, and the buttercups are made out of old sunshine. And I think the sweet peas will be butterflies when they go to heaven. Now, teacher, do you see anything so very queer about those thoughts?" "No, laddie dear. They are not queer at all. They are strange and beautiful thoughts for a little boy to think. And so people who couldn't think anything of the sort themselves, if they tried for 100 years, think them queer. But keep on thinking them, Paul. Some day you are going to be a poet, I believe." When Anne reached home, she found a very different type of boyhood waiting to be put to bed. Davy was sulky, and when Anne had undressed him, he bounced into bed and buried his face in the pillow. "Davy, you have forgotten to say your prayers," said Anne rebukingly. "No, I didn't forget," said Davy defiantly, "but I ain't going to say my prayers any more. I'm going to give up trying to be good, because no matter how good I am, you like Paul Irving better, so I might as well be bad and have the fun of it."
"I don't like Paul Irving better," said Anne seriously. "I like you just as well, only in a different way."
"Well, I want you to like me the same way," pouted Davy.
"You can't like different people the same way. You don't like Dora and me the same way, do you?"
Davy sat up and reflected.
"No," he admitted at last. "I like Dora because she's my sister, but I like you because you're you.
And I like Paul because he is Paul, and Davy because he is Davy," said Anne gaily.
"Well, I kind of wish I'd said my prayers then," said Davy, convinced by this logic. "But it's too much bother getting out now to say them. I'll say them twice over in the morning, Anne. Won't that do as well?"
No, Anne was positive it would not do as well. So Davy scrambled out and knelt down at her knee. When he had finished his devotions, he leaned back on his little bare brown heels and looked up at her.
"Anne, I'm gooder than I used to be."
"Yes, indeed you are, Davy," said Anne, who never hesitated to give credit where credit was due.
"I know I'm gooder," said Davy confidently, "and I'll tell you how I know it. Today Marilla gave me 2 pieces of bread and jam, one for me and one for Dora. One was a good deal bigger than the other, and Marilla didn't say which was mine, but I give the biggest piece to Dora. That was good of me, wasn't it?"
"Very good and very manly, Davy."
"Of course," admitted Davy, "Dora wasn't very hungry, and she only ate half her slice, and then she gave the rest to me. But I didn't know she was going to do that when I give it to her, so I was good, Anne."
In the twilight, Anne sauntered down to the Dryad's Bubble and saw Gilbert Blythe coming down through the dusky, haunted wood. She had a sudden realization that Gilbert was a schoolboy no longer, and how manly he looked, the tall, frank-faced fellow, with the clear, straightforward eyes and the broad shoulders. Anne thought Gilbert was a very handsome lad, even though he didn't look at all like her ideal man. She and Diana had long ago decided what kind of a man they admired, and their tastes seemed exactly similar. He must be very tall and distinguished-looking, with melancholy, inscrutable eyes, and a melting, sympathetic voice. There was nothing either melancholy or inscrutable in Gilbert's physiognomy, but of course that didn't matter in friendship. Gilbert stretched himself out on the ferns beside the bubble and looked approvingly at Anne. If Gilbert had been asked to describe his ideal woman, the description would have answered point for point to Anne, even to those 7 tiny freckles whose obnoxious presence still continued to vex her soul. Gilbert was as yet little more than a boy, but a boy has his dreams as have others. And in Gilbert's future there was always a girl with big, limpid gray eyes, and a face as fine and delicate as a flower. He had made up his mind also that his future must be worthy of its goddess. Even in quiet Avonlea there were temptations to be met and faced. White Sands youth were a rather fast set, and Gilbert was popular wherever he went. But he meant to keep himself worthy of Anne's friendship, and perhaps some distant day her love. And he watched over word and thought and deed as jealously as if her clear eyes were to pass judgment on it. She held over him the unconscious influence that every girl, whose ideals are high and pure, wields over her friends, an influence which would endure as long as she was faithful to those ideals, and which she would as certainly lose if she were ever false to them.
I feel like that goes for any kind of friend. If you are inspiring people with your ideals as a friend, the gender really doesn't matter.
In Gilbert's eyes, Anne's greatest charm was the fact that she never stooped to the petty practices of so many of the Avonlea girls. The small jealousies, the little deceits and rivalries, the palpable bids for favor. Anne held herself apart from all this, not consciously or of design, but simply because anything of the sort was utterly foreign to her transparent, impulsive nature, crystal clear in its motives and aspirations. But Gilbert did not attempt to put his thoughts into words, for he had already too good reason to know that Anne would mercilessly and frostily nip all attempts at sentiment in the bud, or laugh at him, which was 10 times worse. "You look like a real dryad under that birch tree," he said teasingly.
"I love birch trees," said Anne, laying her cheek against the creamy satin of the slim bole, with one of the pretty caressing gestures that came so naturally to her.
"Then you'll be glad to hear that Mr. Major Spencer has decided to set out a row of white birches all along the road front of his farm, by way of encouraging the AVIS," said Gilbert. "He was talking to me about it today. Major Spencer is the most progressive and public-spirited man in Avonlea, and Mr. William Bell is going to set out a spruce hedge along his road front and up his lane. Our society is getting on splendidly, Anne. It has passed the experimental stage, and is an accepted fact. The older folk are beginning to take an interest in it. And the White Sands people are talking of starting one, too. Even Elisha Wright has come around since that day the Americans from the hotel had the picnic at the shore. They praised our roadsides so highly, and said they were so much prettier than in any other part of the island. And when, in due time, the other farmers follow Mr. Spencer's good example, and plant ornamental trees and hedges along their road fronts, Avonlea will be the prettiest settlement in the province. I'm running out of time on Instagram, so I am just... Hashtag not like it. Yes. True. Alas. Anyway, I am going to, because I have 30 seconds left on Instagram, I'm going to stop my Instagram. I'm going to restart it. I will be right back with you on Facebook, Instagram, rejoin in just a moment.
Pardon me while I share this to the IGTV. It used to be... I like some of the changes they have made to Instagram, but some of them have made things a little bit more cumbersome than they were. Alright, posting. Now, back we go. To log in, and there we go. Just going to give it a moment to let the folks on Instagram rejoin. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to post them. I don't mind replying, and as I see them, I do try to reply to you. So if you want to interact, I am happy to have that going on. Let's see. All right, back at it. The aides are talking of taking up the graveyard, said Anne, and I hope they will, because there will have to be a subscription for that, and it would be no use for the society to try it after the Hall affair. But the aides would never have stirred in the matter if the society hadn't put it into their thoughts unofficially. Those trees we planted on the church grounds are flourishing, and the trustees have promised me that they will fence in the school grounds next year. If they do, I'll have an Arbor Day, and every scholar shall plant a tree, and we'll have a garden in the corner by the road. We've succeeded in almost all our plans so far, except in getting the old Bolter house removed, said Gilbert. And I've given that up in despair. Levi won't have it taken down just to vex us. There's a contrary streak in all the Bolters, and it's strongly developed in him. Julia Bell wants to send another committee to him, but I think the better way will be just to leave him severely alone, said Anne sagely. And trust to Providence, as Mrs. Lynde says, smiled Gilbert. Certainly no more committees. They only aggravate him. Julia Bell thinks you can do anything if you only have a committee to attempt it. Next spring, Anne, we must start an agitation for nice lawns and grounds. We'll sow good seed betimes this winter. I have a treatise here on lawns and lawn-making, and I'm going to prepare a paper on the subject soon. Well, I suppose our vacation is almost over. School opens Monday. Has Ruby Gillis got the Carmody School? Yes. Priscilla wrote that she had taken her own home school, so the Carmody trustees gave it to Ruby. I'm sorry Priscilla's not coming back, but since she can't, I'm glad Ruby has got the school. She will be home for Saturdays, and it'll seem like old times to have her and Jane and Diana and myself all together again. Marilla, just home from Mrs. Lynde's, was sitting on the back porch step when Anne returned to the house. Rachel and I have decided to have our cruise to town tomorrow, she said. Mr. Lynde is feeling better this week, and Rachel wants to go before he has another sick spell. I intend to get up extra early tomorrow morning, for I've ever so much to do, said Anne virtuously. For one thing, I'm going to shift the feathers from my old bed tick to the new one. I ought to have done it long ago, but I've kept putting it off. It's such a detestable task. It's a very bad habit to put off disagreeable things, and I never mean to again, or else I can't comfortably tell my pupils not to do it. That would be inconsistent. Then I want to make a cake for Mr. Harrison and finish my paper on gardens for the AVIS and write Stella and wash and starch my muslin dress and make Dora's new apron. You won't get half done, said Marilla pessimistically. I never yet planned to do a lot of things, but something happened to prevent me. The end of the chapter. We will continue tomorrow with chapter 20. Thank you for tuning in, friends. I hope you enjoyed that. I must admit, I like the chapters where we get to hear about Anne getting into mishaps, because they're so entertaining. And she always finds her way out of them, sooner or later. They just, the only thing that gets damaged is possibly pride. And that's an entertaining thing to see. Thank you for tuning in. Tomorrow is Saturday, so it's my day off. So I will not see you tomorrow at 8:30. I will see you, however, on Sunday night. So rejoin me at Sunday night for chapter 20. Stay safe, stay healthy. See you Sunday.